Listening Library presents Talia Talk by Christine Hurley Deriso. Read for you by Becca Battoe. Chapter 1.
Pull, otters, pull! I squinted and puffed out my cheeks. Weighing only about 98 pounds, I didn't have much to offer my team besides fierce facial expressions. Plus, my hands were sore by now, so maybe my squinting would fool people into thinking I was actually trying. Harder, Talia, harder! Busted. My best friend, Bridget, was at the front of our team's line. Bridget had been in front of every line I'd ever been in, but even with me standing behind her, she could tell my heart wasn't in it. Tug of war was totally pointless. But not to Bridget. Bridget was so competitive, she could turn a spelling bee into a contact sport. And tug of war against a team that included Meredith and Bryn? The rope might as well have been a red cape flashing in front of a bull. Bridget would own that rope, even if she had to pull 5 times as hard to compensate for her scrawny teammates. Me being the scrawniest and, let's face it, the least motivated. To Bridget, it was a matter of principle, of willpower, of sheer determination. That, and since she was at the front of the line, she'd be the one to tumble into the muddy creek if we lost. Through my squint, I noticed Meredith and Bryn pulling on the opposite side of the creek bank. Even in the middle of tug of war, their ponytails looked bouncy and their lips glossy. What was it with those two? When had they morphed from scabby-kneed goofballs to dainty princesses? And why hadn't Bridget and I received the morph memo? Pull harder, otters! Bridget bellowed, clutching the rope with one hand while she quickly wiped the sweat from her brow with the other. Which was all it took for Meredith and Bryn's team to give the final heave that knocked Bridget off balance and sent her tumbling into the creek. My fellow otters and I groaned gamely, but didn't exactly have rope burns on our hands. The camp counselor blew a whistle. Game, sea turtles, she said in a last day of camp monotone before adjusting the score on a clipboard. Meredith and Bryn pointed at Bridget thrashing in the ankle-deep creek water and giggled into their fingertips. They dropped the rope and gave each other high fives, then turned to their teammates for more palm slapping. Sea turtles rule, Meredith crowed, which, let's face it, was the understatement of the millennium. If there had been any doubt at the beginning of the week that the sea turtles ruled, by the last day of camp, we were all clear. Weaklings, Bridget moaned as she staggered to her feet and splashed us with creek water. We've lost almost every single competition this week. My fellow otters and I nodded apologetically, but couldn't help sucking in our own giggles. Bridget was covered in mud and looked like she might spin off into space. Her head was shaking so indignantly. It's just a game, Bridge, I said. Just a game? She roared. I might as well have said, just a nuclear war. Meredith and Bryn nonchalantly inspected their nails and tightened their ponytails. So, what's the damage for the week? Meredith asked our counselor. The counselor tapped items on the clipboard, counting as she went along. Sea turtles 10, otters 1. Well, our quilt is prettier, I sputtered, then thought that might possibly be the lamest thing I'd ever said. Maybe you girls better stick to quilting, Bryn said, rubbing her hands on the back of her jean shorts. She and Meredith waved a fluttery goodbye, then headed back toward the mess hall for lunch. The counselor and other campers scattered too, except for me. Bridget had crumpled in defeat back onto the creek bank, and I sat beside her for moral support, ignoring the mud creeping up my thighs. Don't utter a word about camp to my mom, I said, planting my chin in my hand. I can see it now. She'll yak on her show about how hopeless we were in every competition except quilting, and the whole town will send me fabric patches to try to cheer me up. Mom's TV fame had started innocently enough, After my dad died of cancer when I was 7, she got a job doing the morning news for WBJN. Sitting behind a shiny oak desk and reading off a teleprompter, she told viewers about local elections, courtroom verdicts, traffic snags, and other items that fall under the category, things I don't mind the world knowing about. But she was such a hit on the news that pretty soon, her producer asked her to co-host WBJM's chatty mid-morning show, Up and Atom, an hour-long hodgepodge of host chat, interviews, and artsy-craftsy segments. Host chat usually covers items that fall under the category of things I mind the world knowing about. Things like how I threw up on my piano teacher while she played a duet with me during a recital. It was tough enough being a kid, and a half-orphan at that, without everybody in town knowing about my intestinal woes. Viewers always raved about how funny and charming my mom was. Whatever. It never struck me as funny or charming that the whole town knew I had a first-grade crush on the paperboy and just happened to be dusting the porch every time he came by. Why did anyone else need to know about the time I trick-or-treated as a road map because I'd used a permanent marker to connect the dots of my chicken pox? And whose business was it that I glued antlers onto my head with bubblegum one Christmas? Trying not to watch my mom's humiliating tell-alls was like trying not to think about a polka dot elephant when somebody says, "No matter what you do, don't think about a polka dot elephant." Just knowing I was being talked about was excruciating enough. Knowing without knowing the specifics was even worse and drove my imagination into overdrive. "Promise me," I said to Bridget, "if Mom asks how camp was, just say fine." Bridget shrugged. "It's not the worst thing in the world to have a mom who's a celebrity," she said. "Being the kid of a teacher is worse." Bridget was so sure of herself that when she offered an opinion, she sounded like she was reading from a history book. When the Pilgrims landed at Plymouth Rock, they encountered Native Americans who introduced them to maize and explained to them that being the kid of a teacher is worse than being the kid of a celebrity. "No way," I said. "Way." "Prove it, smarty pants," I told her. "Compare and contrast." Bridget smiled like she'd studied the subject and had been waiting for someone to ask. "Your mom can tell the whole town about your rashes," she said, making me cringe with the reminder that, yes, Mom had recently gabbed about my rash. "But my mom," she continued slowly, raising her eyebrows, "is like a walking billboard. My kid is doomed." "Not as doomed as me," I grumbled. "I," Bridget said, "not as doomed as I." I narrowed my eyes. "What are you, my English teacher?" "See, teachers really are annoying." "But even teachers don't blab their kids' secrets all over town," I pointed out. "And we'll be in middle school in the fall, so you won't be in your mom's school anymore." Bridget considered this for a moment, then said, "Well, your mom could be the lunch lady and make you eat leftover school mush every day for dinner. That would be worse than having a celebrity for a mom." And I really couldn't argue with that. Bridget pulled a wildflower from the ground and absently plucked its petals. "Camp used to be so fun," she said. "That's when Mare and Bryn used to be fun," I said. "Now they're just fungus." Bridget looked at me quizzically and I shrugged. It was the best insult I could muster off the top of my head. Funny how Bridget and I had suddenly found ourselves on the outs with Mare and Bryn. Until recently, the four of us had been inseparable, playing kickball in my front yard, building a fort in the woods behind Bridget's house, inventing new Pop-Tart-based desserts in Bryn's kitchen, trimming each other's bangs in Meredith's frou-frou bedroom. It was at the beginning of summer that Meredith and Bryn had started making up excuses not to join us on the trampoline or race through our path in the woods. But even then, we still felt like a foursome. Until camp. They'd acted like they were allergic to us from day one. And Bridget, writhing in the mud on our last day, symbolized the slow death of our friendship. Mare and Bryn had killed it. So, I guess I'll see you when school starts next week. I folded a t-shirt and stuffed it into my duffel bag as Bryn and I packed side by side. Our cots were adjacent in the cabin, but this summer, we'd forgone our usual camp tradition of whispering.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.